very good morning to all of you. I know it's a cold day in Delhi, but it's the roads are clearer than they have to be. And I must confess that one of the things that struck me during the protest yesterday was the sheer creativity of the young minds. The posters that they put out, they're all budding advertising and marketing professionals out there. They knew how to make a good pitch, and clearly this is what the new India is in a sense all about. But I'm glad that today the streets are relatively open, and therefore it was much easier for all of us to come here. Let me say at the very outset, I deem it a great honor that I was asked to be the jury chair in the 10th year of these awards. And we had an extremely interesting afternoon judging these awards. Let me also say, and start off by saying this, that when I told a colleague of mine that I was going to be the jury chair for the IPRCCC awards, the colleague turned to me and said, "What are you doing? A senior journalist like you is going for a PR award ceremony? Surely." So I said, "Why? What's the problem?" He said, "Sir, they represent the other side. We're supposed to look at them as the dark side." And my mind went back to two things. It went back to that famous quote of George Orwell, who said, "Journalism is printing what someone else does not want printed. Everything else is public relations." Now, Orwell, of course, saw, therefore, the battle, much like my colleague had done, as the dark side versus the light side, us versus them. Polarization is not just in politics, it's also between journalists and PR, I guess. Then I thought of another story. In my first month as a journalist, way back in November 1988, I remember attending this editorial meeting at the Times of India in Mumbai, which was being chaired by Girilal Jain. Girilal Jain, for those who are too young, was supposed to be the doyen of journalism in his time, a grizzly old editor who believed that, you know, he had direct access to Rajiv Gandhi, Indira Gandhi, and all the leaders of the time. And in the middle of the meeting, his secretary comes and says, "Sir, someone wants to see you." And he says, "Who is it?" He says, "Sir, wo advertising department se koi aaya." And I distinctly remember Girilal Jain telling the editor, "When the editorial meeting is going on, no one from advertising will come on the editorial floor." This was Times of India, before the Times of India had a response department and the advertorial took over. Can you imagine any editor today telling the person from the advertising department, "I'm too busy, I have no time for you"? The world has changed from the days of Orwell and Girilal Jain. I am a great believer, in a sense, in that wall, that a Chinese wall needs to exist between editorial, advertising, COPCOM. But I'm also a great believer that the conversation must begin. For much too long, we have not talked to each other. We have talked at each other. And that world of Orwell and Girilal Jain is over. So I am delighted to be the jury chair for these awards, because it's given me a sense of what your world is all about. We all live otherwise in our silos, in our echo chambers. And today we cannot afford to do that. Not in this world. This is, as I've called it, the media 360 world. Call it the multimedia age. But it is a remarkable age where the media is constantly evolving, where unless you change with the times, you will be left behind. And you can do it without compromising your ethics and integrity. But for that, you have to open up your minds. And therefore, I believe that for PR professionals, for COPCOM, I don't know whether you like to be called PR or COPCOM. I don't know which is the stronger word. I remember, again, to take the days in the Times of India, we used to sit in the newsroom in the late 80s, early 90s, and we used to always envy the business department during the Diwali week, because whatever gifts were given were only went to the business department. And they came from, you know, in those days, they came with a Reliance shirt piece, occasionally a box of grapes. If you were Sharad Pawar's friend, you got a box of grapes. But if we were in the news covering crime, covering municipality, no one gave us any gifts. There was no PR department handling the BMC. It was another age. And actually, journalists perhaps and PR professionals thought that was okay. That was the nature of the relationship. That relationship, in a complex world, has become much more complex. Quite simply because information is gold. What you really need is to be better informed. In a more complex, complicated world, you need to tell a story. And you need to tell the story well. And frankly, if you want an example of how that is done, you don't need to look any further than Prime Minister Narendra Modi. As part of my marketing exercise, I've learned the game of marketing. I've even got my new book, 2019, How Modi Won India, out there. And you must read it as PR professionals, as marketing, advertising professionals, because I don't think anyone has understood this multimedia age better than Modi. Just look at that 2019 campaign of his, and even the 2014 campaign. There wasn't an aspect of the media. I've called him in the book Prime Time Prime Minister. He has understood prime time better than any editor, better than any editorial owner, and better than any PR professional. There wasn't an aspect of the entire media game that he had. And he would do interviews on Fridays because he knew then it would be carried across the weekend. He would choose the time at which he was going to speak in America so that it was prime time in India. He would choose the kind of people that he would do interviews with, including Akshay Kumar, just before Mumbai is going to vote. So the ability to understand every little aspect, when do I tweet, what do I tweet, what do I put on Facebook, it is a remarkable example of an individual who has no degree in PR, marketing, advertising, but is actually a PhD in it. He should be Dr. Narendra Modi, and Dr. Batra should be actually choosing him as the man of the year in the 10th year of the PR award. He might even come and receive it. Trust me. But honestly, no one has understood this game better. And that's because I think, to his credit, he has been able to open his mind to this new world. There is the darker side of it, of course. Fake news websites, fake news narratives. There's that darker side as well. There is the ability to influence people in a manner that many will see is against the rules of the game, where the ends only matter and the means simply don't. Do whatever it takes in a way to make sure that your message goes across. Even at times, dare I say, tell a lie. And that's in a way where I would advise a word of caution both to Mr. Modi and indeed to PR professionals and journalists. The number of competing fake news narratives that come out have led to this new word that I'm still not able to understand called alternate facts. For every fact, there's an alternate fact. So if you watched Arnab Goswami's program on Republic Channel yesterday, you'd think all of India was burning as a result of protests. If you watched another channel, possibly mine, you would realize that there are large parts of India where people are protesting extremely peacefully. And many of these young people have come out with creative ways of protesting. Now, which fact is true? Yes, it is true that parts of India did burn yesterday. But it is also true that an overwhelming number of people came out, particularly in cities like Mumbai, and protested peacefully. Whose story do you tell? As a journalist, my job is to tell both stories. And tell them with credibility and with concern that in every story there could be two sides. As PR professionals, you will probably have to tell the story that your client has told you to tell. So if you are the PR agent for the BJP, you will probably focus only on the protests, turning violent. If you were a PR agency for someone who was organizing the protests to send out a message that they're against the anti-CAA, then you would tell the story of the peaceful protesters. The challenge for us, in a way, is to tell our story with credibility, to tell our story with authenticity. Because in all these lovely words, these buzzwords that I use today, disruption, synergy, multimedia, the one word that I find is spoken of less and less is credibility. And frankly, to my mind, that is gold dust. When we were judging many of the entries, one of the facts that we looked at was your ability to tell that story with credibility and innovativeness and creativity. Creativity is critical to whatever we do as creative professionals. But credibility is much more difficult. And credibility is not just about one campaign, it's not just about one day. It's the ability to sustain over a period of time the work you do. To give a journalist parallel, you know, we work as journalists in a way, or many TV journalists now work week to week based on TRPs. What are my TRPs of a week in a sense decide almost my self-esteem? I want to redefine TRPs. I believe TRPs must stand for television respect points, not television rating points. We need to earn respect. We need to find ways in which we can earn the respect based on the quality of the work that we do. We are not box office. Now, a PR agency may have targets. Your client may push you to sort of pump up his image or the company's brand image. But trust me, beyond the point, if that brand image has hollowed out because of the reality on the ground, you will be caught up. At some stage or the other, that gap between perception and reality can sting you, as it can sting us in the media as well. We might want to tell a story, but if we don't tell the story well enough or accurately enough, it comes back to bite us. So in a sense, I want to use this address, and obviously you know far more about your business than I do. I do believe that the time has come to ensure that whatever information you put out is done with a complete commitment to the notion that the means matter as much as the ends. That you try in whatever way possible to tell the story as credibly as possible. Because I think when you do that, over a period of time, your audience, your target audience learns to respect you more. And I think if we can find a way that we respect each other also, we respect each other's domain expertise. You have information that I need to know of. And I may not know that sitting in an office today. Let's be honest. Today's news is tomorrow's history. I tell a lot of PR professionals this. They're very worried about one story which has come out, one little news item. What do we do? How do we contain the damage? I say, look, it's out there now. It's on Twitter, it's on Facebook, it's on TV. It's going to get blown up. But today's news is tomorrow's history. Your challenge, therefore, is rather than get panicked, is to actually find ways in which you can build your brand value and your brand equity in such a manner that that one story is not going to affect the big picture. Just as I cannot get swayed by 1 week's TRP, you can't get swayed by that one headline. It's critical that, therefore, you build a kind of equity that goes beyond this today's news is tomorrow's history syndrome. I want to wish all of you a Merry Christmas, a Happy New Year. Santa Claus is a great brand. He's the ultimate good news brand. I've never heard anyone ever say anything negative about Santa. I've heard something said about Diwali because of noise pollution nowadays and cracker ban. But somehow Christmas tends to bring out the best in us. And I really hope that that same Christmas spirit is the spirit that we take into the next decade. It's going to be an exciting time. We don't know what next will come. I mean, when I joined journalism 31 or 32 years ago now, what is it? Sorry, it's 30 years ago, last month. If I had, 31 years ago, if I had 88 November. So if I had joined the profession and not known that, you know, I would not only have to do a story, but I have to tweet about it, put it out on Facebook, do it for digital. And also now, as I've realized, have an Instagram account. I remember my kids finally drawing the line the other day when I told them I'm on Instagram. They said, whatever you do, please don't put a public Instagram account. Surely whatever Instagram account you have has to be private. I said, look, as a media professional, I have no choice. I have to put what I say out in the public domain. So we don't know what this next decade will bring, what new joys and turbulence it will create. But I think it's an exciting time for all of us. And a time where, as I said, we need to celebrate in a way good news. There's too much of bad news on TV. One of the things, and this is my final thought that I leave, and maybe some PR professionals can take it forward with your clients, the time has come for a good news channel in this country. a channel that dedicates itself to positive news about health, education, environment, science and technology. So if you have any client out there who wants to actually pitch and sponsor such a channel, please let us know. We will try and find a way to create a Good News Today channel in 2020 and beyond. All the very best. Thank you very much.